So welcome. I'm delighted you're here tonight. And this is a wonderful tradition for the law school. It's the annual Hayek Lecture. We have a spectacular lecture today. Judge Michael McConnell, who many of us think of as Professor Michael McConnell, but he's now both professor and judge. As many of you know, our first Hayek Lecture was Richard Epstein, who did this 4 years ago and started a great tradition of law school. There's some patterns here which we hope will get repeated. I think Richard came to give the Hayek Lecture. That was his first sort of concentrated time at NYU Law School. I think he spent a week with us. And then I think the next year he spent a semester and taught torts, and then he came a few more times to do that. And he will be joining our faculty, tenure member of our faculty, a year from now. So this is Judge McConnell's first week here at the law school, and we'll see what happens after that. I just wanted to plant the idea while I was up here. Judge McConnell will, in addition to giving this lecture, will be here all week, so many of you will be able to interact with him, and we're very grateful for that as well. He'll be judging the moot court finals tomorrow together with Justice Alito and Judge Motz. He's teaching, he's going to a number of classes, he's meeting with a number of student groups, and I hope you will have a chance to get together with him in one of those contexts. Judge McConnell was appointed to the 10th Circuit. He was one of the leading law professors in the United States. He's a noted expert in two areas, which is pretty hard to be a leading expert in one area. It's a lot harder to be a leading expert in two areas. Judge McConnell has written extensively on constitutional history and on law and religion. He received his JD from the University of Chicago Law School, and then went on to clerk for Judge Skelly Wright on the D.C. Circuit and Justice William Brennan on the Supreme Court of the United States. Not a typical career path for a Hayek lecturer. So, stayed in Washington doing public service, worked at the Office of Management and Budget and in the Solicitor General's office before he joined the University of Chicago Law School faculty in 1985. This is actually very scary for me because that was a year that I joined the NYU Law School faculty. And when I look at all Judge McConnell has accomplished in this period, you know, it's hard not to feel inadequate. I'm not going to tell you all about his scholarship because the point here is to hear from him and not from me, but I'll give you a little interesting vignette. On the University of Chicago, he recruited someone to come as a fellow after being impressed by the comments that this individual had made on one of his articles that this person was editing. This person was President Barack Obama, who, as the president of Harvard Law Review, apparently had made some good comment on one of Judge McConnell's articles. And Judge McConnell continues to be an academic. In his spare time, he teaches every semester. So this is, you know, I'm just stressing this for members of our faculty. No. at the University of Utah. And in addition, also has teaches intensive courses, kind of most recently at Harvard and at Stanford. So it's a great pleasure to introduce Judge McConnell, who will present the Fourth Annual Friedrich von Hayek Lecture on Natural Rights and the Ninth Amendment. How does Lockean legal theory assist in interpretation? Thanks so much, Judge McConnell.
Thank you very much, Ricky. It's great to be back here. It's a real pleasure and quite an honor. It's a particular honor to be giving a lecture in honor of Friedrich von Hayek. I had the pleasure when I was a lowly undergraduate, just starting to study political philosophy and economics, to meet Professor Hayek. This was shortly before he won his Nobel Prize in economics, and I can still remember the effect on me of reading The Road to Serfdom, Constitution of Liberty, and even I think it may have been the first thing I read by him, which is his lovely little essay entitled "Why I'm Not a Conservative." And if I had known then that sometime later I would be invited to be the Hayek lecturer, I would have been bowled over by that. And Hayek is, I think, possibly the greatest modern exemplar of a long tradition which we can call classical liberal legal theory, which is of special interest to those of us who try to understand what the words of the United States Constitution meant to those who drafted and ratified them. Our founders were steeped in this tradition, and much of the terminology in which the Constitution was written and discussed comes from this tradition. And I'm going to be focusing especially upon John Locke, but of course he's not the only figure, and maybe not even the most important to the to the framers. They also were made frequent references to such figures as Vattel and Pufendorf and Rutherford and Grotius and others. And I also don't want to imply that the classical liberal tradition was the only major influence on them. There was, after all, a major influence from republicanism, from Puritan legal thought, from Whig opposition theory, and other sources. So I'm making no claims as to the exclusivity of this a body of thought, but just for its importance as among others. And I think that in particular, classical liberal legal tradition is useful in understanding the concepts of natural rights, retained rights, and delegated powers, which make up the fundamental structure of our Constitution. Locke taught that we all have, by virtue of being human beings, certain natural rights. Natural rights are those rights human beings have in the state of nature before the creation of civil or political society. Every man, Locke wrote, has a property in his own person, along with the products of his labor and that which he mixes with his labor. Indeed, the state of nature is, and I quote, a state of perfect freedom to order one's actions and dispose of one's possessions and persons as each of us sees fit, without asking leave or depending on the will of any other man, up to the limits of the law of nature, which essentially means extending equal freedom to everyone else, not infringing their rights of person, property, or liberty. But it's important to stress that natural rights, so understood, are not the same as what today are often called human rights, that is, rights that must always and everywhere be respected by civil governments. On the contrary, because rights in the state of nature are insecure, lacking a common means of impartial adjudication and enforcement, men enter into a social compact in which they relinquish many of their natural rights in return for more secure protections of those that they retain. Specifically, according to Locke, we give up our natural right to use private violence to punish transgressors, thus giving the state a monopoly on the legitimate use of force for punishment. In addition, and this is a part that some persons of libertarian leaning sometimes forget, each person, quote, is to part with as much of his natural liberty in providing for himself as the good, prosperity, and safety of the society shall require. Now, precisely how much is given up and how much is retained, Locke deliberately does not spell out, for this is not a matter of logical inference. Rather, it is a political, or more precisely, a constitutional choice. That is why the terms of the social compact matter. The social compact is the instrument by which the people decide the boundary between governmental power and individual retained rights. Some peoples will choose to create a broad and omnicompetent government, socialism perhaps, or corporatism, or mercantilism, or theocracy. Others will jealously guard their natural rights and delegate only such powers as are absolutely essential for the purposes of securing liberty and civil peace. Many other peoples will be somewhere in between. This is why the details of constitution making matter, for there is no one, and certainly not judges, with authority to second guess the sovereign act of the people in drawing that line between power and rights. After the Revolution, Americans understood the process of constitution making, first at the state and then at the federal level, as creating a new social compact. That is why they took so seriously the content of the powers delegated and the rights reserved. Interestingly, though, the precise list of powers delegated to the new federal government was not particularly controversial, nor was the list of rights reserved. Once the Committee on Detail decided to enumerate the powers of the new government, there was surprisingly little debate or disagreement about the contents of the list. The debate over the enumeration of powers at the convention lasted only about 3 days and consisted mostly of tinkering with language. A few powers were proposed and rejected, including the power to incorporate, to dig canals, and to create a national university. But the fundamentals were unaffected. The current list of powers in Article 1, Section 8 is pretty close to what was proposed by the committee. Evidently, the committee confined itself to matters about which there was widespread agreement. The same was true of the list of constitutional rights that were proposed by the first Congress, in which we call the Bill of Rights. There was an extensive and interesting debate about religion, a short debate, which I'll describe in a minute, about speech and assembly, and there were many, many amendments to restrict the federal government's powers in various ways, especially with regard to taxation and the military, but most of the first 8 amendments were adopted with surprisingly little discussion. What was controversial and much debated were the structural implications of the lists themselves and what they did not include. Only certain powers are enumerated. Does that mean that other powers are denied to the federal government? Or was the necessary and proper clause, which its detractors called the sweeping clause, a broad grant of additional authority? Only some rights are enumerated. Does that mean that other rights are denied to the people? These issues were addressed by means of what we now call the Ninth and Tenth Amendments, which adopt opposite rules of construction. Under the 10th, the enumeration of powers is deemed to be a denial of all other powers, which are left to the states or to the people. Under the 9th, the enumeration of rights is deemed not to be a denial of other rights, which are left intact. The precise language of these provisions, unlike those of most of the amendments, was seriously debated, especially the 10th. Which anti-federalists valiantly attempted 3 times to strengthen by an insistence on strict construction, each time to be rebuffed. So controversial were these amendments in some quarters that the state of Virginia held up ratification of the Bill of Rights for 2 years over dissatisfaction with the wording. My thesis this evening is that the language and meaning of these amendments can only be understood against the backdrop of Lockean natural rights theory, and that such terms as rights, denied or disparaged, and retained had meanings rather different from what they might be thought to impart today. I'll focus on the enumeration of rights, and thus on the Ninth Amendment, leaving the Tenth Amendment for another occasion. Let us turn then to the fall of 1787 and the summer of 1789, when representatives of the American people adopted the Bill of Rights. As everyone here no doubt is aware, the Constitution as it emerged from the Philadelphia Convention in September 1787 did not contain a Bill of Rights. This was not because of any theoretical or jurisprudential opposition to the idea of a Bill of Rights that emerged later. It was simply for lack of time and attention. No one at the Constitutional Convention in 1787 thought to propose a Bill of Rights until September 12th, 3.5 months after the convention began its work, at a time when the delegates were desperately putting the finishing touches on an agreed-upon plan of government. At that late date, The delegates were anxious to get home, anxious to begin the difficult process of securing ratification, and unwilling to open what could be a Pandora's box of conflicting ideas about fundamental rights. They voted down the proposal to add a Bill of Rights by a thunderous margin of 0 in favor to 10 states opposed. But the convention's rejection of the proposal to include a Bill of Rights within the Constitution turned out to be the anti-federalists' most potent issue during debates over ratification. The opponents of the Constitution hoped to send the document back to a second convention for a round of amendments, and the lack of a Bill of Rights was the most popular reason for doing so. As so often happens in politics, this demand for a Bill of Rights stimulated a response, reasons why a Bill of Rights might be a bad idea. Defenders of a Constitution lacking a Bill of Rights argued, in the words of Alexander Hamilton in Federalist No. 84, that a Bill of Rights would, quote, not only be unnecessary but dangerous. Unnecessary because the Constitution had already protected against abuse by its careful enumeration of powers. Although the new federal government was given important powers, such as to regulate foreign and interstate commerce, to raise and support armies and the like, it was given no power to regulate or license the press, or to establish a national religion, or to do most of the other things that were feared. In light of the enumeration of powers, there was no need for a Bill of Rights. Indeed, as Hamilton said, quote, the Constitution is itself, in every rational sense and to every useful purpose, a Bill of Rights. That meant it was unnecessary. Addition of a Bill of Rights would be dangerous because it was impossible to compose a complete, satisfactory, and compendious list of all the rights of the people. And an incomplete enumeration would imply that items left off the list were no longer recognized as rights. Now, the first argument, while interesting, was clearly wrong, even if Hamilton did make it. The enumerated powers of the federal government might be confined to essential and innocuous matters, but the Necessary and Proper Clause gave Congress discretion as to the means of effectuating these powers. It requires little imagination to see how important individual rights could be abridged in the course of carrying out the limited and enumerated powers of the new national government. Almost everyone could agree that the new government should be given the authority to tax imports. But in the course of doing so, revenue agents searching for contraband might invade the security of a merchant's warehouse without a warrant or probable cause. Most could agree that Congress needed the power to raise armies. But in doing so, they might conscript Quakers or other religious objectors. Congress may lay excise taxes. Newspapers might thereby be taxed out of existence. Cruel and unusual punishments might be used to punish crime. The right to keep and bear arms might be curtailed in the national capital, just to name a few examples. Hypothetically. Now, on reflection, it is evident that enumerating the powers or ends of government would not protect against abusive means of carrying those powers into effect. So it was hard to argue that a Bill of Rights was really unnecessary. The Federalist's second argument carried more weight. Here is how it was expressed by James Iredell at the North Carolina ratifying convention. It would not only be useless but dangerous, Iredell said, to enumerate a number of rights which are not intended to be given up, because it would be implying in the strongest manner that every right not included in the exception might be impaired by the government without usurpation. And it would be impossible to enumerate every one. Let anyone make what collection or enumeration of rights he pleases, I will immediately mention 20 or 30 more rights not contained in it. I suggest you take Iredell's challenge. Sit down some Sunday afternoon and try to draft a Bill of Rights that would contain every right that matters, without being so vague that the list would be subject to misconstruction and evasion. Give your list to a friend and see how many rights you left out. This problem became embarrassingly obvious when the first Congress, bucking to popular demand, attempted to draw up a list. After agreeing to what would have been the First and Second Amendments had they been ratified, having to do with the size of the House of Representatives and limitation on the power of Congress to grant themselves pay increases, ever a popular subject, the House turned to the draft of what is now our First Amendment. The longest debate was over religion. It was inconclusive. They then turned to the following proposal. The freedom of speech and of the press and the right of the people peaceably to assemble and consult for their common good and to apply to the government for redress of grievances shall not be infringed. Sounds pretty good, pretty familiar, very similar to what we actually have. Well, that generated some opposition. Specifically, Theodore Sedgwick from Massachusetts stands up. Sedgwick, accomplished lawyer, a very smart guy. And he complains that adding the right to a freedom of assembly would, he feared it would tend to make them trifling in the eyes of their constituents. He says, if a people freely converse together, they must assemble for that purpose. And it's a self-evident, unalienable right which the people possess. It is certainly a thing that would never be called into question. So once you've specified speech, why do you need to get into all the rest of this minutia? And so he moves to strike out the phrase assemble and. Well, Egbert Benson stands up, and you can almost hear the kind of bureaucratic tone that with which he speaks. He says, the committee who framed this report proceeded on the principle that these rights belonged to the people. They conceived them to be inherent, and all that they meant to provide against was their being infringed by the government. But does this really answer Sedgwick's objection? You know, so Sedgwick comes back and he says that if the committee is governed by that general principle, that is, that all inherent rights need to be protected against the government, well, then they might have gone into a very lengthy enumeration of rights. They might, and this is where I listen carefully to this, they might have declared that a man should have a right to wear his hat if he pleased, that he might get up when he pleased and go to bed when he thought proper, but he would ask the gentleman whether he thought it necessary to enter into these trifles in a declaration of rights in a government where none of them were intended to be infringed. Good examples, don't you think? Well, John Page of Virginia then pops up, and he says that the gentleman from Massachusetts at Sedgwick who made this motion objects to the clause because the right is so trivial in nature. He supposes it no more essential than whether a man has a right to wear his hat or not. But let me observe to him that such rights have been opposed, and a man has been obliged to pull off his hat when he appeared before the face of authority. What is Page talking about? This is a pretty educated audience. How many people here know the incident to which Page is referring? Anybody?
William Tell.
Everyone in the room then would have known what this story, what Page was referring to, because this is a very then famous story involving not William Tell, but William Penn, the founder of the colony of Pennsylvania. And so let me tell you the story of William Penn's hat. Penn, as you presumably know, was a Quaker. Quaker religious meetings were illegal in Britain in the 17th century. And so the Quaker meeting house on what's spelled like Gracechurch Street, but I gather is actually pronounced Gracious Street, was closed. It was locked up so that the Quakers would not be able to have their meeting in the meeting house. And as a result of that, about 200 people gathered outside the meeting house on the sidewalk at Gracious Street. And William Penn proceeded then to address this crowd. And he was then arrested and tried for the crime, or the common law crime, of unlawful assembly. So he's hauled before the court. There's a jury there. In come some witnesses who testify to the fact that indeed he did make an unauthorized speech to this crowd of about 200 people in Gracious Street. That looked like enough. Well, Penn then asks the judge, what crime is that? Where do you find the crime of unlawful assembly in the statute books? And the judge responds that it is a common law crime. And then Penn proceeds to try to argue to the jury that, in fact, a proper understanding of the common law of England, that there's no such crime, and thus he should be acquitted. But the judge shuts him down. He shuts him up, will not allow him to address the jury. And instead, the judge instructs the jury that if they found that Penn had, in fact, done what he's accused of doing, that they should bring in a verdict of guilty. And this actually looks like a pretty easy case, because nobody doubted that Penn had in fact addressed a crowd of 200 people in Gracious Street. And so the jury is out for about 3 hours. A jury comes back, and the foreman, whose name is Edward Bushell, says to the, and the judge says, "Do you have a verdict?" And the judge ask him, "What's the verdict?" And Bushell says, "Guilty of speaking in Gracious Street." Well, what is that? That's not a crime. I mean, when a jury brings in a verdict in a criminal case, what they're supposed to do is find the defendant either guilty or not guilty of a crime. But speaking in Gracious Street is not such a thing. And so the judge says, "That's not a proper verdict. Give us a verdict on what you're supposed to." And Bushell said, "Well, I've not been authorized by the jury to render a verdict anything other than what I've just told you." So the judge sends them back to deliberate some more. And several times they come back, and they keep returning the same verdict and refusing to do anything else, until finally the judge locks the jurors up. The report of the case says that they were locked up without meat, drink, fire, or tobacco, or chamber pot. And deprived of these necessaries, the jury eventually does come back, the judge says to Bushell, "Do you have a verdict?" And Bushell says, "Yes," and the verdict is not guilty. Well, the judge then says, this is contempt of court. I mean, there's no way that you could be following your instructions. There was no doubt that about the facts of this case, and it was your duty to bring in a proper verdict. And so he held the jurors in contempt of court. He fines them 40 marks. Now, I don't know how much money 40 marks is in 1670 in England, but in any event, the jurors then refused to pay, and they are then locked up, jailed for contempt of court. Bushell then sues out a writ of habeas corpus, which is the traditional writ in English law, which allows one to challenge an unlawful detention. It's the same writ which recently has been involved in the Guantanamo cases. And so Bushell and the other jurors claim that their detention is unlawful, and it goes up, and indeed the court holds that they're being unlawfully detained, and the reason for that is that in England, the jury may not be coerced into finding a verdict. The very idea, the very meaning of trial by jury means that the jurors must return a verdict of their own, on their own conscience, of their own judgment. And in this case, Bushell's case, thus still stands. It is still the leading case in Anglo-American jurisprudence for the idea that trial by jury means a trial by an independent and uncoerced jury. And so this is a very famous case in English legal history. And so, but you may be asking, well, what about the hat? You haven't gotten to the hat yet. Well, this is where the story gets really interesting. So Penn has been acquitted by the jury, and he's coming in to receive the verdict. And Quakers do not believe in doffing their hats to authority. But the taking off of the hat was an important part, sort of ceremonial sign of respect to a superior. And so if you appeared before the king, you take off the hat. And if you appeared before the judge in court, you would remove you'd remove your hat. And so Penn prudently refrained from wearing a hat to court that day because he didn't want to be in the position of not removing the hat. He comes in, and at the instruction of the judge, the bailiff claps, just before the judge comes in, the bailiff claps a hat on Penn's head. Judge comes in, Penn does not remove the hat, and the judge fines him for contempt of court, and since he won't pay, he's off to jail. So they get him after all. And so when this is what Page refers to when he says that these rights have been opposed. A man has been obliged to pull off his hat when he appeared before the face of authority. People have also been prevented from assembling together on their lawful occasion. So Page shows with this simple reference to the story of William Penn's hat, think of all of the various constitutional principles that that resonate in the room through a reference to this this familiar story. But Page had somehow made Sedgwick's point for him, and Iredell's as well. It is not possible to make a complete list, and when you include some points of detail, like the right of assembly, Congress will appear to have deliberately left others out. But why is this dangerous rather than just incomplete? Isn't an incomplete list of rights better than none at all? What harm could it do? As John Vining, who steps up next in this debate, says, responding to Page, quote, if the thing were harmless and it would tend to gratify the states that had proposed amendments, he should agree to it. But an incomplete list of rights was not as harmless as Vining thought. Legal instruments, then as well as now, are interpreted in light of a canon of interpretation known by its Latin name, expressio unius. To express one thing is to exclude the others. Expressio unius est exclusio alterius. So here's the way Madison put it when in the first Congress. He says, it has been objected against a Bill of Rights that by enumerating particular exceptions to the grant of power, it would disparage those rights which were not placed in that enumeration. And it might follow by implication that those rights which were not singled out were intended to be assigned into the hands of the general government and were consequently insecure. That, he says, is one of the most plausible arguments I've ever heard urged against the admission of a Bill of Rights into this system. For example, Article 3 provided for trial in criminal cases to be by jury. Critics worried that this amounted to an elimination of trial by jury in civil cases, hence the need for the Seventh Amendment. There were only a few rights protective provisions in the original Constitution, and thus little opportunity for arguments of this sort. But once many more rights were spelled out, the expressio unius problem would become much more severe. And this view was not a partisan or one-sided concern. It was recognized across the political spectrum and from north to south. The Federal Farmer, for example, probably Richard Henry Lee, a leading anti-federalist, put it this way. He said, further, the people, thus establishing some few rights and remaining totally silent about others similarly circumstanced, the implication indubitably is that they mean to relinquish the latter, or at least feel indifferent about them. James Wilson at the Pennsylvania Ratifying Convention. A Bill of Rights annexed to a constitution is an enumeration of the powers reserved. If we attempt an enumeration, everything that is not enumerated is presumed to be given. Or Charles Cotesworth Pinckney at the South Carolina Convention. We had no Bill of Rights inserted in our Constitution, for, as we might perhaps have omitted the enumeration of some of our rights, it might hereafter be said we had delegated to the general government a power to take away such of our rights as we had not enumerated. Note the verbs that these gentlemen used. They did not say that the unenumerated rights would be left to the vagaries of future interpretation. They said that the unmentioned rights would be, quote, assigned into the hands of the general government, that's Madison's words, or relinquished, to use the Federal Farmer's familiar words, language, or given, according to Wilson, or delegated, according to Pinckney. This was the language of Lockean social compact theory. Remember, at the time of the social compact, which for late 18th century Americans meant the time of constitution making, the people make an authoritative decision regarding which powers to delegate to the government and which rights to retain. The essence of the social contract is that we relinquish certain of our natural rights and we receive in return more effectual protection for certain of our rights, plus the enjoyment of positive rights, that is, rights created by the action of political society. Note also that individual rights and governmental powers are reciprocal, two sides of the same coin. The boundary can be expressed by a careful enumeration of powers granted, with others reserved, or by a careful enumeration of rights retained, with the others granted. It comes to the same thing. As Madison wrote in a letter to Washington, quote, if a line can be drawn between the powers granted and the rights retained, it would seem to be the same thing, whether the latter be secured by declaring that they shall not be abridged or that the former shall not be extended. Thus, there are two ways in which the people may imprudently relinquish their natural rights, by means of overbroad delegations of power to the government, or by means of incomplete enumeration of rights, which, as interpreted under the expressio unius canon, is the same thing as the grant of an additional power. Now, Madison proposed a solution to this problem, an amendment that, unlike all the others, had no precedent in state constitutions or state proposals for the Bill of Rights. He proposed, quote, the exceptions here or elsewhere in the Constitution made in favor of particular rights shall not be so construed as to diminish the just importance of other rights retained by the people, or as to enlarge the powers delegated by the Constitution, but either as actual limitations of such powers or as inserted merely for greater caution. It's interesting to note that although rights and powers are two sides of the same coin, Madison separated and distinguished them in this proposal, proposing that the enumeration of rights would not be so constructed as to either, quote, diminish the just importance of other rights retained by the people, or, and the or is Madison's or, quote, as to enlarge the powers delegated by the Constitution. This draft also makes clear that at least some of the rights in the Bill of Rights were actual limitations on the power of Congress. We may regard them as clawing back certain rights that otherwise would have been delegated to the Congress through the Necessary and Proper Clause. For example, Congress had the power to support armies, but under the Third Amendment, it could not do so in times of peace by quartering soldiers in private homes. Thus, the Third Amendment is a restriction upon the power of Congress granted by the authority to support armies. This shows that Madison did not believe that retained natural rights would operate on their own force if not carved out of the reach of the Necessary and Proper Clause. Now, the Select Committee streamlined Madison's draft, giving it the form of the current Ninth Amendment, which I'll quote, "The enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people." So that's the Ninth Amendment. What does it mean? What protection is accorded the rights retained by the people? Supreme Court has never said. So we're in the realm of speculation. There are two leading schools of thought regarding the meaning of the Ninth Amendment. One, exemplified by Professor Kurt Lash's work, and by the way, his book on recovering the lost Ninth Amendment has just come out in the last couple of weeks. He maintains that the Ninth and Tenth Amendments together are a guarantee of federalism, that is, limitations on the power of the national government. According to Lash, the Tenth Amendment limits federal powers to those enumerated in the Constitution, while the Ninth Amendment guarantees against a broad construction or interpretation of those powers. The other view, recently exemplified by Professors Randy Barnett and Daniel Farber, among others, translates the Ninth Amendment as follows, and I'm quoting from Barnett, "The unenumerated natural rights possessed prior to the formation of government and which they retain afterwards should be treated in the same manner as those natural rights that were enumerated in the Bill of Rights." In other words, all natural rights are now constitutional rights, whether they're enumerated or not. We may call this the fully enforceable rights interpretation. Under it, the judiciary is empowered to determine what those natural rights are, how far they extend, and to what extent they may be regulated or curtailed. Exactly how this works is a bit sketchy, but Professor Barnett tells us that judges would, quote, "scrutinize a regulation of liberty to ensure that it is reasonable and necessary rather than an improper attempt by government to restrict the exercise of the retained rights." Now, just what makes a restriction on natural liberty reasonable and not improper is difficult to say. Reasonable minds often differ, sometimes passionately, on these topics, and judges have not been vouchsafed any special afflatus to aid in the enterprise. It seems to call for a normative judgment. Professor Farber seems to think that the protections of the Ninth Amendment extend to, but only to, rights that the Supreme Court, in its wisdom, has, by happenstance, chosen to recognize under what he agrees is the specious grounds of substantive due process. Professor Barnett's view seems to be broader than that. In any event, both schools of thought, the federalism view and the fully enforceable rights view, make arguments from history, and this recent scholarship has contributed greatly to our understanding. But with all respect, I think both schools of thought fall short. In the written version of this lecture, I will explain why I disagree with Kurt Lash's interpretation. Tonight, I'll confine my critique to the fully enforceable rights construction. Specifically, I think that this view is inconsistent with major elements of the Lockean natural rights tradition, which form the basis for the Ninth Amendment. First, this theory assumes that all natural rights are retained rights, which is simply not so. Social compact theory holds that the people relinquish many of their natural rights. So the idea that the unenumerated rights are necessarily given the same degree of protection, protected in the same manner as the enumerated constitutional rights, just cannot be true. Locke says that each person is, quote, "to part with as much of his natural liberty in providing for himself as the good, prosperity, and safety of the society shall require." We relinquish certain natural rights and thereby secure the protection of civil society for our retained natural rights plus the positive rights created by society. Now, this leads to the second problem with the fully enforceable rights theory, that it regards the actual terms of the social compact, the Constitution, as irrelevant. If all retained natural rights are to be treated in the same manner, without regard to the terms of the Constitution, then the careful drafting of the Bill of Rights was pointless. The framers could have left out most of the rights on the list, or maybe not enacted a Bill of Rights at all, and it wouldn't have made no difference. This is contradicted by Madison's insistence that the Bill of Rights were actual limitations on the powers of Congress. Without a Bill of Rights, the Necessary and Proper Clause would effectively delegate to Congress the choice of means for effectuating its powers. That is why a Bill of Rights was necessary in the first place. The theory also appears inconsistent with Madison's explanation to the first Congress that as a result of the Bill of Rights, quote, the independent tribunals of justice will, quote, be naturally led to resist every encroachment upon rights expressly stipulated for in the Constitution by the Declaration of Rights. If all rights are treated the same way, whether they are stipulated for or not, Madison's statement ceases to make any sense. Now, third, and perhaps most important, this school of thought leaps from the language of the amendment that the rights retained by the people not be denied or disparaged to the conclusion that these rights have been elevated to the status of constitutional rights superior to legislation. That is not what it says. What then does the Ninth Amendment mean if we reject both of these prominent academic interpretations? I ask you to consider this possibility, that the rights retained by the people are indeed individual natural rights, but that they enjoy precisely the same status and are protected in the same way that they were before the Bill of Rights was added to the Constitution. They are not relinquished, denied, or disparaged, but neither do they become constitutional rights. They do not become trumps. So how were retained natural rights protected prior to the Constitution? Partly, of course, through our representatives in Parliament or the legislature. The protection of the rights of the people was one of the major purposes of representative government. But Anglo-Americans were a legal culture, and rights enjoyed legal protection even before some of them were enumerated in the form of a written Bill of Rights. I'd like to describe now two prominent cases that were handed down in the 10 or 15 years immediately prior to the adoption of the Bill of Rights. And I would submit that these cases are typical, but I obviously can't prove that in the course of a short evening. But the first is Rutgers against Waddington, usually cited, often cited as one of the great examples of judicial review prior to the Constitution. This is a case which, incidentally, Alexander Hamilton represented the defendants in this case, arose here in the city of New York as a result of the British occupation, military occupation during the American Revolution. The plaintiff in the case, Elizabeth Rutgers, owned a brewery and ale house. Now, she was a loyal patriot, and she fled the city when the British occupied New York. And was away then for, I believe, about 4 years during the revolution. Well, the British military authorities, they wanted a beer, and so they licensed the operation of the brewery and ale house to some people, ultimately represented by Waddington, and so they operated this during the course of the revolution. And then later, when the American Patriot troops come back in and take over in New York and the revolution is over, the legislature of New York passes a number of anti-Tory measures, including what is called the Trespass Act, which was an act granting property owners whose property had been used by the occupying forces during the revolution to an action in damages. Now, the problem with this is that it was a fairly well-established principle of international law that military occupying forces have the right to use abandoned property in the occupied territories without the need to pay any damages. And so there's a conflict between this recently enacted state statute and a well-recognized principle of international law. So what's the court to do? The court rules largely in favor of the British defendants, and here's the reasoning. The court begins by stating, the supremacy of the legislature need not be called into question. if they think fit positively to enact a law, there is no power which can control them. The court begins by a proposition of legislative supremacy. When the legislature enacts positive law, then it can't be displaced by general principles of international or natural law. Going on, quoting some more, when the main object of such a law is clearly expressed and the intention manifest, the judges are not at liberty, although it appears to them unreasonable, to reject it, for this were to set the judicial above the legislative, which would be subversive of all government. But what the court then did was it gave a very narrow, actually quite a grudging interpretation to the words of the statute, and ultimately concluded, and I have to say that I think this is a bit of a legal fiction, ultimately concluded that it could not have been the intention of the legislature in this particular case for to countermand the requirements of international law, and thus the British defendants prevailed. But what the court said is, the judges are in decency to conclude that the consequences in this particular case were not foreseen by the legislature, and therefore they are at liberty to expound the statute by equity and only, quote, hawk to disregard it, meaning in the particular case. When the judicial make these distinctions, they do not control the legislature. They endeavor to give their intention its proper effect. The second case I wanted to mention is Somerset's case, a British case involving slavery. A Virginian brought his slave named Somerset to London, and and Somerset escapes. He's recaptured and he's held in chains in a ship in the Thames. Some abolitionists got some lawyers and they sue out a writ of habeas corpus to challenge the legitimacy of Somerset's detention, and so it comes down to the question of, is slavery lawful in England? And an opinion by Lord Mansfield, an extremely distinguished judge, really the founder of modern commercial law, Mansfield said that the state of slavery is of such a nature that it is incapable of being introduced on any reasons, moral or political, but only by positive law, which preserves its force long after the reason, occasion, and time itself from which it was created is erased from memory. It, slavery, is so odious that nothing can be suffered to support it but positive law. He then proceeded to canvass the statute books and common law precedents of England and concluded that there was no positive law authorizing slavery, and therefore Somerset was free. Note that the decision expressly would not apply where there was positive law. For example, in what Mansfield refers to as the plantations, that's the colonies, where there was positive law establishing slavery, a different result would have taken place. Now, these cases have several important features in common. First, they recognize certain sources of unwritten law, natural law, the law of nations, as authoritative. But second, they regard these unwritten sources as subordinate to and potentially displaced by the enactments of the legislature. That is to say, the cases accept the premise of legislative supremacy when express constitutional limits are not involved. As Chief Judge Duane put it in Rutgers, quote, the supremacy of the legislature need not be called into question. If they think fit positively to enact a law, there is no power which can control them. This relation between unwritten law and legislation is familiar to all of us. It's how we think of common law and legislation today. Remember, we're talking about retained rights before there was a constitution. But the ultimate question was one of legislative intent. Did the legislature really intend a result that conflicts with natural law or the law of nature, of nations? In service of this inquiry, the courts used the principle of narrow construction of the statute. Again, as Chief Judge Duane put it, the result in question must be, quote, clearly expressed and the intention of the legislature manifest. When not, the judges are in decency to conclude that the consequences were not foreseen by the legislature. As we can see from these examples, natural rights exist and were enforceable in court, but they were not trumps. Rather, they were background principles or default rules which could be displaced by positive law, but only when the law is specific enough to demonstrate that the legislature really and truly intended for them to be displaced. Courts would not give statutory language broad sweep. They would presume, in the absence of clear indications to the contrary, that the legislature did not intend the statute to be interpreted in a way that would violate the traditional rights of the people. Now, constitutional rights are different. Expressly enumerated constitutional rights have the same juridical status as expressly enumerated constitutional powers and are understood as limitations on those powers. Congress shall make no law. Thus, in our system, constitutional rights are trumps. When constitutional rights are involved, the question is not whether the legislature really and truly intended to displace them. We don't care. If because it's a constitutional right, it must not be abridged, no matter how intentional or explicit the intended invasion may be. Thus, I agree with Professor Barnett that the Ninth Amendment creates a presumption of liberty with respect to natural rights, but contrary to Professor Barnett, and in contrast to constitutionalized rights, the presumption may be defeated by a showing that the people or the people's representatives acting pursuant to delegated power explicitly intended to relinquish a claimed right. It is not up to the courts to decide, based on their own preferences or ideology, whether a restriction on liberty is reasonable and necessary, to use Professor Barnett's terminology. The point, after all, is to vindicate the exercise of popular sovereignty, that is, the social compact, and not to empower judges to second-guess the people's decisions regarding the boundaries of retained rights and delegated powers. Now, I leave it to you to evaluate whether such a form of judicial review has advantages over our modern alternatives. But for now, I would suggest only that reference to Lockean natural rights theory might be a helpful way to open our minds to a different understanding of unenumerated rights and constitutionalism. Thank you.
That was great. Do you have any couple of questions?
That was wonderful, Judge McConnell. And Judge McConnell very graciously agreed to answer a couple of questions. I think we have time for two, and it probably makes sense to walk to the microphone so that Al.
That all sounds great in the abstract, but the Utah Supreme Court decided a case 30-some years ago that may call it into question. The Utah legislature passed a statute that said a court may take a child away from its parents whenever it is in the best interests of the child to do so. Not abuse or neglect, just simply best interests of the child. The Utah Supreme Court, in an opinion by Dallin Oaks J., said that that legislation violated the Ninth Amendment. How would you handle that case?
Well, I don't know. I don't know the particular case. It actually reminds me a bit of the more recent, what, 5 or 6 years ago now, Supreme Court case of Troxell against Granville, which involved a Washington statute that allowed the courts to decide that parents to be able to compel parents to allow any other person visitation rights. The particular case involved grandparents, but the statute was extremely broad, and the Troxell case divided the U.S. Supreme Court in interesting ways, with a few of them led by Justice Thomas sort of seeming to champion something akin to the fully enforceable rights view, with Justice Scalia leading a group that essentially took the view that if there's not an enumerated right, it's not a constitutional right, and then some other justices trying to engage in balancing and not taking a particularly clear position one way or the other. I think that if this view that I've been suggesting were to be put forward, what you would say is there is indeed a natural right of parents to control the upbringing of their children, and then you would ask whether the statute is specific enough and explicit enough to justify the conclusion that the people of Washington State intended to divest that natural right. And given the extraordinary breadth of the statute, it would seem to me that that this might be that might even be an easy case for my suggested view, because that statute is I would suggest is, I mean, if you were to apply a sort of Rutgers versus Waddington strict construction to the statute, would not be held in that particular case to be sufficient to divest the natural right. So I would say that the parents would prevail in that case. But then, if the legislature were to pass a carefully focused statute specifying more specific limitations upon the parents' rights with respect to visitation, that might very well prevail. So that there isn't an all or nothing proposition, parents always win, state always wins, but rather a question of requiring the representatives of the people to engage in deliberation and address the very specific and difficult moral questions and that are raised.
My question is, it might be a simple question, but I think Locke also had something to say about the ability to delegate the legislative power. And in today's administrative state, does that make a difference about whether, you know, there is positive law that is has a Lockean sort of imprimatur of the people?
Well, it does make a difference. It's very hard, I think, to map our modern administrative state onto any coherent understanding of either the original Constitution or of natural rights theory. I'm beginning with the problem that through the process of delegation and sub-delegation, people who are not, in fact, representatives of the people, bureaucrats, indeed officials who have been deliberately insulated from the will of the people, make decisions which affect natural liberties. So that our Congress is not, our representatives are not necessarily the folks who are deliberating and making these choices. Instead, it's a step removed. And I mean, I don't want to get into a lengthy history of this, but in another aspect of this sort of pre-constitutional legal regime was that the courts had much more authority to enforce common law natural rights norms against subordinate institutions of government. They call them corporations, which doesn't mean something like, you know, General Motors, or it's not a business corporation. A corporation was more like a public corporation, a city, a guild, that kind of enterprise, and or a colony, by the way. And courts did enforce natural rights and common law rights more aggressively against those entities than they did against a parliament itself. That not every institution that is an arm of the state was regarded as exercising sovereign power. Now, whether it would be even conceivable to resurrect something along those lines in the modern administrative state, I'd be exceedingly skeptical. If you wanted to engage in that kind of imaginative reasoning, it might be a place to start.
Thank you. The Hayek Lecture is a joint venture between the law school and the Journal of Law and Liberty, and I'll call Dan Myler, who's the outgoing editor-in-chief, to come up here.
Judge McConnell, we thank you. And your lecture tonight will appear in Volume 5, Issue 1 of our journal, which will be released in the fall. But just as a small memento of our thanks, we have a gift to give you to remember your trip to New York by.
And the conversation can continue now in the back of the room, informally, at our reception. Thank you so much for coming, and thank you so much, Judge McConnell.